Good evening. Welcome to Abundant Life International Online Bible Study on Zoom. We thank God that we completed the book of Daniel. And last week we did on chapter 11 and 12. And today we are doing the book of Ruth. Ruth's love demonstrated in chapters 1 and 2. Let us pray. Lord, we thank you for your faithfulness all these months, that you have sustained us even through the lockdown. Thank you, Jesus, that you have spoken to our hearts. We have heard from your word. We have obeyed your word. And thank you, Lord, for all the blessings that have come in our lives. Thank you, Lord, for everything that you have done for us. And we bless your name this evening. And we pray for all those who have come on Zoom. Be with each one. And we pray every interruption to go and all the gadgets would function rightly. Give us clarity of mind and spirit. And thank you, Lord, that you move by your spirit this evening. Speak to our hearts, Lord, that we would live for your glory. Thank you, Jesus. In Yeshua's name we pray. Amen. Amen. The book of Ruth is a journey of faith. It is a journey of love, hope, and destiny. From Mo Tizard's book, we see that Ruth is uncovering hidden treasures. The new is in the old concealed, and the old is in the new revealed. The time of Ruth, totally it is 12 years. The country of Moab, which is verses 1:18, we see that it was 10 years. We are doing the book of Ruth. A journey of faith, hope, love, and destiny. According to Mo Tizard's book, Ruth is uncovering hidden treasures. The new is in the old concealed. The old is in the new revealed. The total time of the book of Ruth is 12 years. The country of Moab was 10 years. A field in Bethlehem, which went on for months. A threshing floor in Bethlehem was 1 day. The city of Bethlehem, 1 year. So totally it is 12 years. The key word is kinsman redeemer. The Hebrew word goel. The word goel or kinsman redeemer appears 13 times. It means one who redeems. The key verses of the book of Ruth is Ruth 1:16 and 3:11. Let us read. But Ruth said, "Entreat me not to leave you or turn back from following after you. For wherever you go, I will go. And wherever you lodge, I will lodge. Your people shall be my people, and your God, my God." 3:11. "And now, my daughter, do not fear. I will do for you all that you request. For all the people of my town know that you are a virtuous woman." Amen. The three main characters of the book are Naomi, which means pleasant, Ruth, which means friendship, Boaz, which means strength, and later on we see Elimelech, which means my God is king. Let us read Ruth 1-5, chapter 1, verses 1-5. "Now it came to pass in the days when the judges ruled that there was a famine in the land, and a certain man of Bethlehem, Judah, went to dwell in the country of Moab, he and his wife and his two sons. The name of the man was Elimelech, the name of his wife was Naomi, and the names of the two sons were Mahlon and Chilion, Ephratites of Bethlehem, Judah. And they went to the country of Moab and remained there. Then Elimelech, Naomi's husband, died, and she was left and her two sons. Now they took wives of the women of Moab. The name of one was Orpha, and the name of other Ruth, and they dwelt there about 10 years. Then both Mahlon and Chilion also died. So the woman survived her two sons and her husband. So sad, isn't it? Ruth's need to remain with Naomi. We see that Elimelech was running from his situation of suffering to a better place, from death and famine and lack and poverty, but death followed him. Some people are running away from their situations. In the Bible, we see so many of them. To name a few, we see that Hagar was running away from Sarah. Jonah was running away from God and his call. Joseph was running away from Potiphar's wife. We see that Elimelech was running from Bethlehem. And we know in Micah 5:2, the coming Messiah is promised here. But you, Bethlehem Ephrathah, though you are little among the thousands of Judah, yet out of you shall come forth to me the one to be ruler in Israel, whose going forth are of old from everlasting. We know that the book of Ruth was during the time of Judges. There were famines, and famines were sent by the Lord upon Israel as a judgment because of spiritual decline. Going to a country outside of Israel to live was forbidden by the Lord. And yet, we will see how the Lord would take this wrong and turn it into right, but with great loss as accompanies all failures. Because of famine, however, better to be in famine in that which belongs to the Lord, as did Israel, than to be in a place of prosperity and it be filled with idolatry, as was Moab. Deuteronomy 11:13-17, we see, "And it shall be that if you earnestly obey my commandments, which I command you today, to love the Lord your God and serve him with all your heart, with all your soul, then I will give you the rain for your land in its season, and the early rain and the latter rain, that you may gather in your grain, your new wine, your oil, and I will send grass in your fields for your livestock, that you may eat and be filled. Take heed to yourself, lest your heart be deceived, and you turn aside and serve other gods and worship them, lest the Lord's anger be aroused against you, and he shut up the heavens so that there is no rain, and the land yield no produce, and you perish quickly from the good land which the Lord is giving you." Ruth 1:3-5, we see that if we are out of God's will, there is always suffering and death. and death is very painful as you lose your loved ones, loneliness, and there are orphans and widows and so many things happen. Verse 4, it is not forbidden in the law for a Hebrew to marry a Moabite woman, but a Moabite, because of being cursed of God, was forbidden to enter the congregation of the Lord. That we see in Deuteronomy 23:3, an Ammonite or Moabite shall not enter the assembly of the Lord, even to the 10th generation. None of these descendants shall enter the assembly of the Lord forever. However, faith could overcome that which it did with Ruth. Amen. Two books in the Bible are named after women, Ruth and Esther. We know that Ruth, a Gentile woman, marries a Hebrew, and Esther, a Hebrew woman, marries a Gentile. So we see the turn here, and both marriages predict as told, and blessings followed them. Acts 3:25, you are the sons of the prophets and of the covenant which God made for your fathers, saying to Abraham, and in your seed all families of the earth shall be blessed. Amen. That the Gentiles, such as are to be brought in the kingdom of God in connection with Israel. It is very easy, spiritually speaking, to go into wrong directions. However, very hard to leave that wrong reactions and wrong directions in order to come back to the right way. We see sad things happen in verse 5. Both Naomi's sons die, and more suffering for Naomi, and she's helpless and miserable. Let's read from verse 6 to 13 of chapter 1. And she arose with her daughters-in-law, that she might return from the country of Moab. For she had heard in the country of Moab that the Lord had visited his people by giving them bread. Therefore she went out from the place where she was, and her two daughters-in-law with her, and they went on the way to return to the land of Judah. And Naomi said to her two daughters-in-law, go, return, each to her mother's house. The Lord deal kindly with you, as you have dealt with the dead and with me. The Lord grant that you may find rest, each in the house of her husband. So she kissed them, and they lifted up their voices and wept. And they said to her, surely we will return with you to your people. But Naomi said, turn back, my daughters. Why will you go with me? Are there still sons in my womb that they may be your husbands? Turn back, my daughters. Go, for I am too old to have a husband. If I should say, I have hope, if I should have a husband tonight and should also bear sons, would you wait for them till they were grown? Would you restrain yourself from having husbands? No, my daughters, for it grieves me very much for your sakes that the hand of the Lord has gone out against me. Ruth's opportunity to leave Naomi. According to the Jewish Targums, they say that an angel spoke to her and gave her this instruction. In other words, the famine was over. It lasted a number of years, and now she has got this news. Verse 8, we see that it seems that Naomi at last had no faith at this stage. But there was little faith in the promises of God, such as the experience that she had of her own disobedience. She was discouraged, and she was discouraging her daughters-in-law to return and not come with her. However, the same faithlessness that caused her and her family to leave Israel plagued her still now. But we shall see, when she returns to Israel, her faith will begin to come back now. Moab was not a place of faith. As a world system, it was never the place of faith. Israel was a place of faith, and as it is presently, spiritually speaking. Verse 9, Naomi knew that there was no rest in the land of Moab because of it was a place of idolatry. But verse 10, by the statement she makes, your people, they are speaking as well of Israel's God. Verse 11, once again, doubt and unbelief rule here. Naomi was walking by sight instead of by faith. Such direction always limits God. Verse 12 and 13, in other words, she said, wait until they were grown, not marrying anyone else. Naomi felt that she suffered tragic loss of a husband and two sons, of being out of the will of God. And now leaving to go back to Israel, she remembered that God does not work from what might have been, but rather from what is. Amen. Verse 14. We see that Orpah left and we never hear from her again. Sad. But Ruth clung to her mother-in-law. The cling word, or clung, Hebrew word, is D-A-B-A-Q, which means to cling, to stick, stay close, to cleave, means to cling faithfully to somebody or something, clinging like glue. That is told of marriage, of being cleaving and becoming one flesh. Amen. Proverbs 18:24, there's a friend that sticks closer than a brother. Verse 15, from the statement unto her gods, it is obvious that the great contending factor here was the gods of Moab versus the gods of Israel. The God of Israel. Orpah chose her gods and missed the greatest thing that could ever happen in any individual, that is eternal life. It seemed that Naomi did not want to promise them, and she would not, the promise that she would not fulfill. They had to choose. They had to make a choice what they wanted to do. Let's continue reading from verses 14. Then they lifted up their voices and wept again, and Orpah kissed her mother-in-law, but Ruth clung to her. And she said, look, your sister-in-law has gone to her people and her gods. Return after your sister-in-law. But what did Ruth say? Entreat me not to leave you or to turn back from following after you. For wherever you go, I will go. And wherever you lodge, I will lodge. Your people shall be my people, your God, my God. Where you die, I will die, and there will I be buried. The Lord do so to me, and more also, if anything but death parts you and me. When she saw that she was determined to go with her, she stopped speaking to her. Now the two of them went until they came to Bethlehem. And it happened when they came to Bethlehem that all the city was excited because of them. And the woman said, is this Naomi? But she said to them, Do not call me Naomi, call me Mara, for the Almighty has dealt very bitterly with me. I went out full, and the Lord has brought me home again empty. Why do you call me Naomi, since the Lord has testified against me, and the Almighty has afflicted me? Verse 22. So Naomi returned, and Ruth the Moabite, Moabitess, her daughter-in-law with her, who returned from the country of Moab. Now they came to Bethlehem at the beginning of barley harvest. Amen. Ruth, whose name means friendship, will not be moved. She is determined not to lose what is left of her family, and she became a member of the family when she married Mahlon, the eldest son. She was accepted in the family and she was blessed. Ruth made a commitment to Naomi that involved every area of her life. She turned away from her old life, her old identity, and moved towards a new life with Naomi and with her people. Amen. She was converted. The Hebrew word for converted is repent in the Old Testament, which is SHWB, to turn, and the Greek word for repent in the New Testament is METANOEO, metanoeo, to think differently. Amen. Where you go, I will go. Where you stay, I will stay. Your people will be my people. Your God will be my God. In her heart and in her mouth, she confessed that Naomi's God, the Lord God of Israel, was now her God. No looking back, no turning back, like Lot's wife, who turned into a pillar of salt as she turned towards the world and things of the world. Romans 10:10-13, but verse 13 says, everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. His name Jehovah means eternal, unchanging, who was and who is to come. Amen. Jehovah Jireh means the Lord my provider. Jehovah Shalom, the Lord my peace. Jehovah Rophika, the Lord my healer. Jesus died for us. He took our sins upon himself, and we accepted him as our Savior. We were brought into covenant with the Father, with the Son, and with the Holy Spirit. Amen. We were no people, but now we are his people. We were no one, but now we are someone. We were destroyed and were going to hell, but now we have a new destiny, eternal life in Jesus Christ. Amen. Covenant is binding agreement between two parties, each giving themselves to completely to the other. Covenant is a means of protection and mutual advantages for both parties and for their families. Covenant cannot be entered into lightly, and it involves responsibilities. So there are some covenants in the Bible that we will see now. First is Edenic covenant, and we see the description, tree of knowledge of good and evil, and the sign for this covenant was death. Adamic covenant, fallen man, seed of the woman, and the sign is seed. Noahic covenant, not destroy the earth again by floods, and the sign was rainbow. Mosaic covenant, the law and the sign was Sabbath. Palestinian covenant, the land of Canaan promised to God's people, and the sign would be blessings or curses. Davidic covenant, David's rule, everlasting kingdom. New covenant, church and millennial blessing, which comes as a sign of baptism and Lord's Supper. Eternal covenant, it is described as redemptive, and which comes a sign in Jesus Christ. Amen. Two types of covenants which are illustrated in the Bible are, there is a love covenant which is always offered by the greater towards the lesser, never the other way. We see this in 1 Samuel 18, 1 to 4, where Jonathan offered to make a covenant with David, and you all know about it. The second one is a business covenant, which was usually initiated by the weaker towards the stronger. And we see that in Joshua 9, 6 to 16, where the Gibeonites tricked Israelite leaders into making a covenant with them. And we know what was the result of that. Covenant helps us to understand God's character and His promises, and it helps us to interpret circumstances. Amen. Verse 17, this has one of the greatest statements of affirmation of salvation founded in the entity of the Word of God. In essence, it is that which must characterize all who come to Christ. In this consecration, there is no looking back. The die is cast. Ruth now, she will forever not turn her back on God, but turn her back forever from the world of idolatry, rebellion against God, and totally committed to Him. Even when she dies, she does not want to go back to Moab, but rather buried in the land of Israel. She cuts herself and her ties from her past, her family, and everything else. This is exactly the consecration that is demanded by God of all who come to Him. Anything less is no salvation at all. Amen. Verse 18, we see Naomi saw that Ruth was determined. She was not going to change her mind. This must be the character of all believers, or every believer. Ruth and Naomi returned to Bethlehem. Verse 19, the words they said of calling out her name itself proclaim a wealth information. They carry the idea that poverty which enveloped Naomi was obvious to all. Her husband and two sons have died. They were not there with her, and she is accompanied by a Moabitess, which was a reproach within itself. Little did the people of Bethlehem realize that the Moabitess would be the ancestress of the Messiah. Naomi was honest over here. Call me not Naomi, but call me Mara. I am not pleasant, but I am bitter. This has been correct maybe, but the Lord has not dealt bitterly with Naomi. While problems may be allowed by the Lord, they are because of our wrongdoings and certainly not His. The Lord does not punish us. The Lord does not put us in problem. It is our own doings. It is our own sin that leads us into all this problems. Verse 21, again a sad statement from Naomi. I went out full and the Lord has brought me home empty. We hear so many stories of people selling all their gold, all their wealth, just to get a job abroad. And when they go abroad, if they are cheated and they are made to do work that is not according to what they have written a contract, then it is so sad when they return, they come empty. And when they come empty, there is nothing to fall back upon, and they are left and they are bankrupt. So same was the state of Naomi. She's saying she went out full, but now the word afflicted means good for nothing. It means crushed and broken to pieces as by a blow. She was open and honest about her feeling. She was brought to the ground. Imagine the humiliation and the brokenness that she has been through. She was right when she said to her friends and neighbors that she has come back empty. She has come to the place where the Lord can bless her once again. She has started from the right place. As we often say, let us start from the cross. Amen. There's a story told about a little girl in a village where she lost her way. She did not know where she was. They kept asking her questions. Baby, where's your house? Where do you live? Please tell us. She says, I do not know anything. I cannot remember anything. But in the middle of that junction, there is a cross. Take me to that cross and I will know my home. And today this is a lesson for us. Come to the cross. Whatever your difficulties, whatever your problem, lack, poverty, sickness, disease, come to the cross. Only in the cross there is divine exchange and you will be blessed. The Lord will take away your poverty, your sickness, your lack, and your everything negative, and He will bless you. He will fill you. He will give you, and He will extend your borders. He will take you to a spacious place and bless you. Amen. Something has to die in order to get us to assess our situation. We need to turn around and return where we knew that things were right. Naomi had the guts to return. It was a humbling step, but she returned. Returning back to God is one step in the right direction, followed by another. Amen. We see that Bethlehem was during barley and Passover. Returning to Bethlehem, Judah, we saw in Genesis 35:19, we see that Jacob's wife Rachel died and was buried in Bethlehem. It was the beginning of barley harvest, which was around March to April, and then is the wheat harvest, April to May. We see in John 6:9-10 that 5 barley loaves and 2 fish were used by Jesus for the miracle to feed 5,000 men and plus women and children. Barley loaves being an indication of humble status of those who followed Jesus around the area of Galilee. And we see that the Feast of Unleavened Bread, Feast of Pentecost, and the Feast of the First Fruits, now it is known as Sukkot. Leviticus 23 or Deuteronomy 16 talks about it. They arrived to celebrate the Feast of Passover, as mentioned in Exodus 12. Bethlehem in Hebrew is Bethlehem, house of bread. John 6:35 says, I am the bread of life. Naomi was a good and godly mother-in-law, a good example to her daughter-in-law. In her thinking, empty described her situation. However, she was far more full than she could even begin to think. Rather, would prove to be the greatest blessing of all. Unbelief often sees us empty, while faith sees us full. Have faith, have faith. The Holy Spirit wants us to know who Ruth is, that we may know what Ruth becomes. He is the same time telling us that He changed Ruth's life. He can change our lives as well. Barley harvest, this was April. Passover time, in fact, the Holy Spirit is saying, when I see the blood, I will pass over you. There is no sin the blood cannot cover. There is no life the cleansing of the blood cannot change. It will change Ruth. It can change me. It can change you.
Amen.
Amen. Let us read chapter 2, verses 1 to 7. There was a relative of Naomi's husband, a man of great wealth, of the family of Elimelech. His name was Boaz. So Ruth the Moabite said to Naomi, please let me go to the field and glean heads of grain after him in whose sight I may find favor. And she said to her, go, my daughter. Then she left and went and gleaned in the field after the reapers. And she happened to come to the part of the field belonging to Boaz, who was the family of Elimelech. Now behold, Boaz came from Bethlehem and said to the reapers, the Lord be with you. And they answered him, the Lord bless you. Then Boaz said to his servant, who was in charge of the reapers, whose young woman is this? So the servant who was in charge of the reapers answered and said, it is the young Moabite woman who came back with Naomi from the country of Moab. Verse 7, and she said, please let me glean and gather after the reapers among the sheaves. So she came and has continued from morning until now, though she rested a while in the house. Amen. We see here that Boaz is making his entry, and Boaz is the kinsman that they are looking out for. And Boaz is a type of Christ. Ruth, a Gentile, is a type of the church. The terrible losses in the life of Moab portray the dispersion and thereby the judgment of Israel. Boaz will prove to be the kinsman redeemer of Ruth. There in Hebrew, word for kinsman and redeemer is only has the right to redeem. The one who has the right to redeem, who was a kinsman. Hence, it was necessary for us that Lord Jesus Christ should become man in order to redeem us men. Amen?
Amen.
Ruth's marriage and the wealthy home into which she was brought pictures the satisfying joy and fullness of blessing which union with Christ secures from the heart that trusts Him. Verse 2, this portrays the fact that Naomi was poverty stricken. The welfare system, if Israel in that day had, which was given by God in the law of Moses, stated that the poor during the harvest would go into the fields and glean the living, the leftovers. In this law, the reapers were instructed to go glean the corners of the field and to leave a little something along the way. Verse 3, we find that Ruth, although beautiful young lady, was a hard worker, and she was knowing the will of God in her life, and she obeyed, and her steps were ordained by the Lord. She did not know where to go, but miraculously the Lord took her into Boaz's field. Of course, the Holy Spirit was guiding her all the way, and the Lord's plans were beautiful. They are much beautiful, and the results are 100%. They are better than our plans. Amen. For we know in the Word, the plans that the Lord has for us are not to harm us, but to give us a hope and a future. For His thoughts are higher than our thoughts. Amen. We need to submit to His Lordship, to His thoughts, to His plans. Amen. Boaz was a wealthy man. Verse 4, he was from the tribe of Judah and in direct line of the Messiah. He was the son of Salmon and Rahab. We know the two spies that went to Rahab. One of them was Salmon, and later he married Rahab. Imagine what a wonderful thing that happened. Joshua 2 shows us that Joshua and the army took 5 to 6 years to conquer the many kings that ruled the land. Boaz inherited that land from his father, and he had made people to work in that field for him and in the land that God had blessed him. Verse 5, God's hand was over Ruth's life. Leviticus 23:22, Israelites' law made provision for the poor and the foreigner to do this. Isaiah 58:11 also. This question, even though asked casually by Boaz, who she was, to be answered by the Holy Spirit. We know that Ruth was to be the great grandmother of David, and thereby of the son of David. Amen. Verse 6, to those around her, Ruth was reduced to the level of gleaning, and she was poverty stricken. Also, she was a foreigner, a Moabitess. Verse 7, Ruth speaking to the servant, she has reaped constantly, only resting a short time in the house. She was well looked after and helped by the people around her. God's favor was on her life. Let us quickly read from verses 8 to 16. Then Boaz said to Ruth, "You will listen, my daughter, will you not? Do not go to glean in another field, nor go from here, but stay close to my young women. Let your eyes be on the field which they reap, and go after them. Have I not commanded the young men not to touch you? And when you are thirsty, go to the vessels and drink from what the young men have drawn." So she fell on her face, bowed down to the ground, and said to him, "Why have I found favor in your eyes that you would take notice of me, since I am a foreigner?" And Boaz answered and said to her, "It has been fully reported to me that you have done for your mother-in-law since the death of your husband, and how you have left your father and your mother and the land of your birth, and have come to a people whom you did not know before. The Lord repay your work, and a full reward be given to you by the Lord God of Israel, under whose wings you have come for refuge." Then she said, "Let me find favor in your sight, my Lord, for you have comforted me and have spoken kindly to your maidservant, though I am not like one of your maidservants." Verse 14, now Boaz said to her at meal time, "Come here and eat of the bread, and dip your piece of bread in the vinegar. So she sat beside the reapers. He passed parched grains to her, and she ate and was satisfied and kept some back. And when she rose up to glean, Boaz commanded his young men, saying, "Let her glean even among the sheaves, and do not reproach her." Verse 16, "Also let grain from the bundles fall purposely for her. Leave it that she may glean, and do not rebuke her." Amen. We see here he is commanding her. The word to hear or listen is shama. And we know Deuteronomy 6, 4 and 5, it says, "Shama Israel. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength. And these words which I command you today shall be in your heart." Verse 9, which says, "Stick to these women and not go to another direction." Behind the harvesters were always poor people, poor women. And Ruth was under Naomi's covering, and she was doing what Naomi told her and gave her permission to do. Boaz gave her permission also to glean alongside, which showed favor and compassion. And she bowed down to Boaz. Yeah, she was amazed of the favor and protection shown to a foreigner. Deuteronomy 10:19. "Therefore, love the stranger, for you were strangers in the land of Egypt." 14:29 says, "And the Levite, because he has no portion nor inheritance with you, and the strangers and the fatherless and the widows who are within your gates may come and eat and be satisfied, and the Lord your God may bless you in all the works of the land which you do." Boaz knew the word, he followed the word, and he had compassion on Ruth, like he was a type of Jesus. As Jesus showed compassion on the adulterous woman, and we know that Leviticus 20:10 says both adulterers and adulteress were to be stoned to death. Jesus did not break any law. He was following the law, and he wanted witness that time, and people were not willing to witness and stay till the end. Staying till the end meant the victim had to be killed. We see verse 10, a Gentile. Boaz had done far more than merely taking notice of her. His action, how he did, what he did for Ruth was truly great. Verse 11, Boaz makes it clear, and he has informed her, and he knew that she was converted and she had come to the Hebrew faith, leaving her own people, her own gods, and she had come to be with God of Israel and the people of Israel. And here again we see that Boaz was a wise man. Verse 12, and he gives her the blessing. He was a man of authority and a male relative, and he was protecting her. We see a repay means reward your work. And Hebrew word salem, which means to be covenant of peace, richly rewarded, is salem, which means to be complete, safe, peaceful, perfect, whole, full of peace. In salem, in the end, it is shalom, which is our peace, our welfare, our life giver, our wholeness. Amen. Under whose wings you come to take refuge. The word canop, an edge or extremity, a wing of a bird or an army, or edge of a garment. From canop we get the word canopy. Exodus 20:5, 20 and 37, 9, which describe the wings of the cherub, which overshadow the covering of the mercy seat, which is the seat of atonement. Mercy seat was the place where God could meet with man. In Psalm 91, verse 4, He will cover you with His feathers, and under His wings, under canop, you will find refuge. Hide me under the shadow of your wings. In the Gospel of Luke, when Angel Gabriel talks to Mary, the Holy Spirit will come on you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Mary had an encounter with the wings of an angel. The presence of God came over her. In His own way, Boaz welcomes Ruth into the family. She places herself socially beneath the other Jewish girls and who are gleaning, with the idea in mind that she is a Gentile woman. Verse 14, still Ruth does not actually know who Boaz is. She is given invitation to come and to dip her bread in wine vinegar so they could fellowship and get to know each other. And it was a time of communion, bread and wine. Red wine contains minerals including iron, magnesium, potassium. It contains acetic acid, which can help digestion. The dip that was there, it was a wine sauce. A sauce is prepared by boiling and reducing the water content in the wine. Ruth was asked to dip her bread into wine vinegar. Good recipe, isn't it? I prepared it and we had it for breakfast this morning. It was good, tasty, yummy. You can try it. Verse 15, I have told the men not to lay hands on you. That means I have commanded the man not to touch you, not to abuse you. And Boaz wanted to see safety of Ruth. Verse 16, Boaz in his instruction instructs the reapers that they need to, according to the law, he need to favor. Before that, she was favored with handful of grains which were to be dropped just for her. We see that Joseph gave Benjamin 5 times more. He favored Benjamin because he loved Benjamin. And so also Boaz favored Ruth. In Psalm 25, let me not be ashamed. Let not my enemies triumph over me. David knew that shame is linked with the loss of power. Amen. Towards the end, we have come now, verses 17 to 23. So she gleaned in the field until evening and beat out what she had gleaned, and it was about an ephah of barley. Then she took it up and went into the city, and her mother-in-law saw what she had gleaned, and she brought out and gave her, and she had kept back after she had been satisfied. And her mother-in-law said to her, where have you gleaned today? And where did you work? Blessed be the one who took notice of you. So she told her mother-in-law with whom she had worked and said, the man's name with whom I work today is Boaz. Then Naomi said to her daughter-in-law, blessed be of the Lord who has not forsaken His kindness to the living and the dead. And Naomi said to her, this man is a relative of us, one of our close relatives. Ruth the Moabitess said, he also said to me, you shall stay close by my young men until they have finished all my harvest. And Naomi said to Ruth, her daughter-in-law, it is good, my daughter. that you go out with his young woman, that people do not meet you in any other field. So she stayed close by the young woman of Boaz to glean until the end of barley harvest and wheat harvest, and she dwelt with her mother-in-law. Amen. Verse 17, and ephah which she carried to town and gave her mother-in-law, according to Exodus 16:36, an omer is 1/10 of an ephah. So that is, an omer weighed between approximately 1.5 kg. And an ephah must have weighed around 15 to 17 kgs. How she carried so much of grain from the field to her mother-in-law, we do not know. The workers had dropped many stalks of grain for her to pick up. It must have been very heavy for her to carry. But she knew that her mother-in-law was hungry, and she had saved some roasted grain from her lunch for her mother-in-law to ensure that her mother-in-law gets something to eat immediately after she got home. Wonderful daughter-in-law. Such a beautiful relationship, because God was with them. And we see there was no cultural differences, because the mother-in-law made her comfortable every time. Verse 18, she had gleaned far more than Naomi had thought she would be able to. She was a strong woman. Boaz had shown kindness not only to the living but to the dead, because he was their guardian, redeemer. Boaz's acts of kindness for the widow and the foreigner showed that he feared God and his word. He was the defender of fatherless and the widows. Naomi is happy that Ruth was in Boaz's field. Verse 20, he was their goel, he was their redeemer, and he was type of Christ. As we said before, she worked, and we see that verse 20, the living were Naomi and Ruth, but the mercy and favor was shown even to the dead. Yeah, because he had to buy the field back from the relative's property and marry the widow. Amen. When a Hebrew was forced to sell his inheritance because of poverty, the nearest relative was to redeem it from him. Leviticus 25:25. If one acted as a kinsman redeemer for one who has died without a son, he was not under obligation to marry the widow. Boaz had no right to redeem the property unless the nearest kinsman refused, which he did later. Verse 21, in other words, Boaz told Ruth not to glean in others' field because Boaz wanted to see Ruth happy. And it was during barley harvest, which was in April, and we see all the feast here. During the time of feast of wheat harvest, which came in the latter part, which was part of May and early June, was to be feast of Pentecost, and it was 50 days after Passover. Stay close to the servant girls until the barley and the wheat harvest were finished. There was enough provision for both. Amen. There was enough food for Naomi and Ruth. God will not leave us. God will not forsake Amen. Us. And He will look after us. He will protect us. He will provide for us. Our bank balances will not run dry, because He will bless our bank balance. He will bless our flour and oil. And He will give us enough and to spare. As we are generous and giving people, God will bless us. Thank you, Jesus. Let us pray. Lord, we thank you. Through the story of Ruth, Lord, we have learned, Lord, that you are our kinsman redeemer, Jesus, and you had mercy on us. Thank you, Lord, for all that you have done for us. Thank you, Lord, we were empty like Ruth, but we are full now because of you, Lord, because our heart was empty, but we have called you, Jesus, into our heart. You have been Lord and Savior of our lives, of our family. You have blessed us abundantly. There is overflow, there is celebration, there is a harvest, and there is no lack. Thank you, Lord. Those who are with us, Lord, and those who are associated with us are blessed. And you are making them overflow, Lord, and they will lack nothing. And we pray for abundant blessing on each, all the viewers, Lord, all who are hearing, Lord. May they lack nothing. Give us hope, Lord, to hold on to you, Lord. Remove our hopelessness, Lord. Remove our misery, Lord. All famine is going. All lack and poverty is going. And God is blessing us. Lift your hands up and receive His blessing. The Lord is blessing you. May the blessings of Abraham, Isaac and Jacob be yours. May the blessing of Rachel and Leah be yours. In Yeshua's name, Amen.